Hey, good morning. Thank you again to the organizing committee for inviting me to participate in this. So for the next 18 minutes, I'm going to talk to you about the U.S. perspective on liver cancer, and specifically, I'm going to try and highlight some areas in which the different epidemiology, as well as the practice guidelines in the United States, vary from our Far East colleagues and how they sort of play themselves out in the imaging realm as it relates to screening, diagnosis, and surveillance imaging. I have no disclosures relevant to this presentation. So as you just heard from the prior two speakers, liver cancer is actually a real big problem worldwide, right? If you look at the WHO data from 2018 audits, you can see that HCC is actually the sixth leading diagnosis, sixth in overall new cancer diagnosis with about 840,000 cases, and fourth leading cause of cancer mortality worldwide with just over 780,000 deaths worldwide attributable to HCC. So that's a really significant problem on the worldwide stage. When you juxtapose that with the United States perspective, you actually see some really discrepant numbers. In the U.S., HCC comes in as 14th in terms of overall new cancer diagnoses and 7th in terms of cancer mortality. And if you look at the contribution that the U.S. actually plays to the overall worldwide statistics, we account for about 5% of the overall incidence of HCC and about 3.5% of cancer deaths worldwide. So really, those numbers are shockingly different in the U.S. stage versus the world stage. And so some might be inclined to ask, why do we spend all this time and money researching and developing strategies for both diagnosing and treating such a low incidence cancer? But if you peer into the data that comes out of the NCI SEER program, you can actually see some interesting answers to that. If you look at the trend line for some of the most common cancers in the United States, like breast, lung, prostate, and colon, you'll notice that over the past 10 years, there's actually been a dramatic decline in both the incidence and the mortality of those cancers. But if you look at HCC, there's actually been a shocking increase in both the U.S. cancer incidence and the U.S. cancer mortality of HCC. And so consequently, I think this makes the point that we aren't really at the sort of leading edge of treating this. And in fact, it's becoming a bigger and bigger problem for U.S. citizens. Similarly, as the prior speaker alluded to, there are some significant epidemiologic differences between why HCC occurs in Western populations and Eastern populations. The most common cause of HCC in the United States is hepatitis C, which accounts for roughly 60% of cases. And hepatitis B, as was alluded to earlier, is actually a relatively low contributor to U.S. etiologies. Now, the story for chronic hepatitis C infection is actually changing in the United States, right? Recall that chronic hepatitis C infection is typically an infection that takes years, if not decades, to manifest itself in terms of advanced fibrosis and cirrhosis. And that's important because most patients with hepatitis C infection don't develop hepatitis cellular carcinoma until they have cirrhosis, right? So the risk prior to the development of advanced fibrosis is actually relatively low, but there's a dramatic jump in the per annum rate of HCC development after you have advanced fibrosis. Interestingly, the new treatment strategies with these direct-acting antiviral therapies have really shown significant improvement in the overall risk stratification for people developing HCC who have chronic hepatitis C infection. So that is to say, the patients that have a sustained viral response with these DAA treatments have actually had marked reduction in HCC incidence, but it does not fully eliminate that risk. So while the story is actually relatively reassuring in the U.S. about chronic hepatitis C infection, it's actually very disturbing for what's happening with metabolic syndrome and fatty liver disease. This has been a significantly increased problem in the U.S. over the past 20 years and actually is affecting East Asian populations, as was previously alluded to as well. In fact, some estimates suggest that of about 30% of new HCC cases in the United States are linked to metabolic syndrome. So similar to chronic hepatitis C infection, when metabolic syndrome or fatty liver disease progresses to cirrhosis, i.e. NASH cirrhosis, there's a dramatic jump in the per annum risk of developing HCC. So how does this translate from practice, or how does this translate rather into practice and into imaging? I acknowledge that not every center is the same, right? So every center or even every practitioner may have their own practice patterns. But in general, the USA abides by the American Association for the Study of Liver Disease, or AASLD, guidelines. And most gastroenterologists, hepatologists, and transplant surgeons support this because it really provides a nice uniform framework to talk about the three different arms of screening, diagnosis, and treatment for hepatocellular carcinoma. And importantly, as was referenced in the last presentation, the 2018 guidelines, or the update, practice update from the AASLD, they've integrated LIRADS and the Barcelona Clinic system into their specific imaging and staging recommendations. And so consequently, this is a real feather in the cap or a crowning achievement for the steering committee and those that have pushed so tirelessly to make LIRADS such a success. It's important to acknowledge that OPTN still remains a key component of the transplant workup, and I'll get into that in just a moment. So from a screening perspective, what do we do in the United States? Well, the AASLD recommends screening at-risk patients every 6 months with an ultrasound plus minus an AFP. And the population that we screen is actually relatively specific. It's patients who have been identified to have a potential survival benefit by early detection and potential intervention for hepatocellular carcinoma. And you'll see that in the United States, most of those populations are people with established cirrhosis, whether that's from hepatitis B, hepatitis C, or other causes of cirrhosis, including NASH cirrhosis down here. There are some ethnic minorities with a chronic hepatitis B carrier status that are also advocated in screening, but they are a relatively small contributor to the overall screening population. As I mentioned a second ago, because of the coherency now with the AASLD practice guidelines and the LIRADS system, there's been an adoption both in the screening and in the diagnosis of HCC. And so one nice thing about the LIRAD system is that it provides a uniform lexicon for both reporting and ultimately managing findings. And so as our last speaker touched on briefly, you know, surveillance ultrasound in the United States is sort of stratified into one of three potential outcomes now using the LIRAD's criteria. It's either normal or negative, in which six-month follow-up is recommended. It contains a sub-threshold observation, which is an observation that's less than 10 millimeters in size, and that should be followed up with a 3 to 6 month ultrasound. Now, that is to say that there's many places that would recommend a CT or an MR for this, but this is, in fact, the recommendation by LIRADS, and this is what we should be doing as a general practice. There are also then studies that are obviously positive, studies that have an observation that's 10 millimeters or more, or there's new tumor thrombus, and in these circumstances, it's appropriate to get a diagnostic study, either a liver CT or a liver MR. That screening recommendation actually mirrors many of our sister colleague societies, as you just kind of saw, but there is a pragmatic implication in the United States that's difficult and perhaps somewhat unique to our population currently, which is that about 20% of screening ultrasounds are actually non-diagnostic or inadequate. And that's because of the high propensity for metabolic syndrome or fatty liver disease to affect patients in the United States. And so, as I'm sure you see in your practice routinely, this is one patient from our practice just a few weeks ago, where you can see that this person has obvious cirrhosis with a nodular hepatic surface contour on their right upper quadrant ultrasound, high echogenicity indicative of underlying fat, but you can see that there is very poor penetration of the sound beam through this fatty liver, right? You basically would have a non-diagnostic evaluation of much of the right hepatic lobe. And so the AASLD recognizes this, and importantly, so do the payers and the insurers, because in certain patient populations, particularly those with fatty liver disease, they have opted to support using other studies, including diagnostic studies like liver CT or liver MR, as a screening mechanism, acknowledging that this is an insufficient way to actually screen patients for HCC in these patient populations. Now, for diagnosis, as the past speaker mentioned, we typically have used diagnostic imaging as the way to make the diagnosis of HCC rather than invasive tests because of the high specificity in patients with chronic liver disease. And so, as I mentioned, the 2018 practice revision to the AASLD guidelines now endorses the use of LIRADS as the primary way for making the diagnosis. Because of the limited time I have for this, this is really not intended to be a primer of how to use LIRADS, but I'm going to touch on sort of the salient features that govern clinical diagnosis and practice. Recall that LIRADS essentially takes any lesion or observation and stratifies it into one of many different categories, but primarily five different categories, ranging from definitely benign or LIRADS 1 to definitely malignant or LIRADS 5. And these definite malignant cases are the cases that are image diagnosis of HCC. So how do we get to that? Well, you probably, if you've used LIRADS, you've probably seen this table, right? And this is the table that has had subtle adjustments to it made over the course of several of the LIRADS revisions. But notice that all the LIRADS 5 sort of sit down here in this corner. So what are the diagnostic components that influence this? Well, they're all things related to the lesion or the observation. One, is there arterial hyperenhancement? Two, what is the lesion size? And three, what major factors exist for this lesion? Is there a delayed enhancing capsule? Is there intralesional washout or non-peripheral washout, or is there threshold growth? And so consequently, you can see that if it's a non-hyperenhancing lesion, you can't have a LIRADS 5 based on that. If it's got a hyperenhancing lesion that's less than 10 millimeters, the best it could be is a LIRADS 4 as well. And then if you have a large hyperenhancing mass, all you really need is one or more of these additional major features to qualify as a LIRADS 5. And the really, the conundrum comes into this smaller lesion category, the 10 to 19 millimeter lesions, right? So if you have 10 to 19 millimeter hypervascular lesion and it has at least two of these major features, then you indeed have diagnostic features to call it a LI-RADS 5. If it is, in fact, 10 to 19 millimeters but only has one of these additional major features, then you need to look very critically at what feature is present. If it's the enhancing capsule alone, that is not sufficient enough to call it a LI-RADS 5, and it gets triaged to a LI-RADS 4 observation. If, on the other hand, it has intralesional washout or threshold growth, those both qualify as LI-RADS 5 criteria as an individual single criteria. And so this is one simple example from our practice. Here's an obvious LI-RADS 5 lesion, a bilobe 2.5 centimeter mass in the right hepatic dome. It's hypervascular here on the arterial phase imaging, shows obvious intralesional washout and delayed capsule-like enhancement. This is a no-brainer. Now, LI-RADS does allow for the movement up and down between those other features. So in between definitely benign and definitely malignant, you have varying areas of malignancy potential. And so consequently, people have developed these ancillary features to help one move up or move down. And there's listed here, you can see some of the ones that perhaps are most common are nodule and nodule architecture, intralesional fat or subthreshold growth. Things that favor benignity are size stability or size reduction. And while most of these things are sort of a two-way street, you know, you could go up or down depending on what you initially place the lesion to be and then which way the malignant features either sway for or against that. Notice that at the 4-5 or LI-RADS 4-5 junction, it's a one-way street. You can only take a LI-RADS 5 observation and make it a LI-RADS 4 observation with ancillary features. And again, in my experience, that's typically with size stability or reduction. You can't take a LI-RADS 4 lesion and make it a LI-RADS 5. And said a different way, LI-RADS 5 lesions must adhere to those major criteria. And I think that's critically important because that helps set the basis for why LI-RADS and OPTN now work pretty well together. So let's take a step back and talk about OPTN. In the United States, OPTN and UNOS are two sort of brother-sister organizations that work hand-in-hand with one another to develop, to distribute transplant grafts based on fairness and medical necessity. And so consequently, patients with hepatocellular carcinoma are placed on the transplant list, and they are given special exemption points based on the amount of disease that they have. Because we don't want people who have potentially curable disease dying on a transplant list from metastatic disease when they have still salvageable disease. And so consequently, the OPTN diagnosis or OPTN classification of their lesions is very critical in order to help put them appropriately on the list. And so the OPTN criteria are really those that are held in great reverence by transplant centers, and consequently, LI-RADS and OPTN have worked very hard to sort of get to a single ground on this. And so while they are currently closely aligned, they are not perfectly aligned, and let me show you that in just a moment. Here's a table that talks about how you get to an OPTN 5 classification. Again, it's not to walk you through all the minutiae of this, but it's to simply show you that many of the same features apply that we just talked about with LI-RADS. Size, hypervascularity, presence of washout and capsule-like enhancement or threshold growth. But notice that in OPTN 5 lesions, for small lesions between 10 and 19 millimeters, you not only have to have hypervascularity, but you have to have both washout and capsule-like enhancement. This is a yes and yes. Or it could be hypervascularity and threshold growth. It cannot be one of these individually. For the larger lesions, you can have either washout or peripheral rim enhancement, either at 5B level or 5X level. And so there are some key population differences between who LI-RADS and OPTN applies to. LI-RADS, generally speaking, can be applied to any practice setting, although there are some excluded patient populations here due to differences in lesion sensitivity or specificity. OPTN really is preferred only at transplant centers, and there's really not an excluded population, which is to say that any patient who is considered a transplant candidate can have the OPTN classification scheme applied to them. So as I mentioned, because of the goal to try and make this relatively synchronous or make it clear in practice patterns throughout the U.S., LI-RADS has tried to become nearly coherent with OPTN, and it remains one sole exception, which is that lesion that's 10 to 19 millimeters that shows hypervascularity on the arterial phase imaging, but shows only intralesional washout and no delayed capsule-like enhancement or threshold growth. In LI-RADS, this is a LR5 lesion. In OPTN, this is not classified. So it's obviously better to show this in a case example, and I'll show you one case from our institution here where that plays itself out. Here we have an 11-millimeter hypervascular mass in the anterior right hepatic lobe. On the delayed post-contrast imaging, you can see there's obvious intralesional washout, but there's no capsule-like enhancement around it. There is no comparison examination to assess for threshold growth. So by LIRADS, this is an LR5 observation because it meets one of those major criteria in that middle box where it's a specific major criteria. In the OPTN classification schema, this is unclassified. So this patient was followed for 3 months, and at that time, the lesion then grew. It was now 14 millimeters. It again shows intralesional washout, but on the follow-up examination, you can now see a partial capsule-like enhancement around it, now fulfilling two major criteria. So this is now a LIRADS 5 lesion and an OPTN 5 lesion, and these are, in fact, coherent at this point. The reason that LIRADS is beneficial is because it gives you relatively granular treatment recommendations as well. So it helps standardize not only the classification and the nomenclature of lesions, but also what to do with them. So that may be anywhere from return to surveillance imaging or definitive action based on LIRADS 5 lesions, but also may recommend other imaging or even tissue biopsy if necessary. And again, from an auditing standpoint, it's interesting because you can now track what these lesions end up becoming, right? So LIRADS has done a nice sort of look back at some of the data that they have already collected, and you can see that at the extremes, LIRADS 1 and LIRADS 5 actually mimic the BI-RADS experience where there's 0% HCC in LIRADS 1 and a 94% rate of HCC in LIRADS 5 lesions. Note that the middle lesions have a relatively larger swath of HCC in them. I'm going to spend the last minute and a half here just talking about post-treatment imaging or surveillance imaging. And traditionally, this has been a real ambiguous or vague topic because it's been purposely made so. So OPTN calls treated lesions 5T, and the prior incarnation of LIRADS had a simple thing, LR treated, which did not address the presence or absence of residual viable tumor. In the most recent revision to LIRADS, you can see that they've now added three discrete categories to assess treatment response. And this is nice because it, again, provides granularity and some guidance for what to do with the management of these patients, ranging from a TR non-viable, equivocal, and viable, specifically often with nodular or mass-like eccentric enhancement in or around the treatment fossa. Again, just to give you two case examples from our practice, you can see this is a TR non-viable one, a well-treated lesion with thermal ablation where on the arterial phase imaging and the later venous phase imaging, there's no mass-like or eccentric enhancement in or around the treatment cavity. On the other hand, this patient who had a drug-eluting bead TACE therapy has significant residual nodular enhancement. You can see this hypervascular focus along the anterior aspect of the treatment cavity, which shows a little bit of isointensity or even perhaps some hypointensity on the later phase of imaging. So this is obvious recurrent tumor. So in summary, there's certainly key epidemiologic differences between HCC and East Asian and U.S. populations, and particularly as it relates to hepatitis C infection and fatty liver disease. In the U.S., the AASLD guidelines are relatively well accepted and adhered to throughout the country, and they have helped standardize the practice. As I mentioned, the endorsement of LIRADS into the AASLD guidelines is really a significant improvement and helps improve verbal consistency and give some management recommendations. OPTN remains a little bit dysynchronous with LIRADS in that one category of a small lesion, but overall they are relatively well aligned. And the increased granularity about discussing post-treatment results is very welcome, particularly at centers that do a lot of local regional therapy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Liu, for the wonderful presentation. I'm very glad I'm a chest radiologist because I think long rads is much easier than light rads. Next, we have Dr. Wall Lee from Seoul National University Hospital, representing the Korean Society of Radiology, who's going to talk to us about gastric cancer from the Asian perspective.